morning, everyone. Am I audible? Okay. So if someone can turn off the slide. Yeah. So I'll tell you something, that this particular topic, computational intelligence to quantum intelligence, very frequently, I mean, in the course of my working to the time I became an academician, I've been baffled by this question from people. But okay, where is the stop of this learning? So many new techniques coming up, technology, algorithms. So where is the end to it? What is this leading to? That has baffled me for quite some time. And this is actually a working paper which I'm working on as to where the technology will lead to us. Some hypotheses are there. I'll make some assumptions. I'll throw some questions. And in the process of the talk, I'll try to demystify some part of it, right? Okay, so for this talk, so here are some of the acknowledgements. Some people who have helped set up this particular talk, some labs where state-of-the-art works are happening in the area of quantum machine learning, competitive intelligence, fuzzy logic. And obviously, the main person whom I would like to be acknowledged is this guy, Richard Feynman. So he's a physicist, a world-known physicist, and back in 1982, he was the one who said that the quantum computing is going to change the face of how we process information, how human beings race ahead in time. So yeah. So this is how the talk is organized. First, I'll have a look into Turing's prediction. Alan Turing, what he predicted way back in 1952. Cognition and intelligence, we'll just give a brief overview of that. Coming to cognitive systems, that how cognitive systems helps in overall computing part. Then coming to computational intelligence, some illustration I'll give for computational intelligence, applications, some limitations, quantum computing, singularity, and finally, the conclusion. So yeah. So way back in the 15th, Alan Turing said that, I believe that in about 50 years' time, it will be possible to program computers with storage capacity of about 100 KB to make them play the imitation game so well that an average integrator will not have more than 70% chance of making the right identification. Just see the statement. He's saying that within a time span of 50 years, computers with just memory of 100 KB, they will be able to process information, process data, so that an average integrator will not be able to distinguish whether it's a man or a machine, right? And then he raised the question of whether is it possible for machines to think or not. So this was actually the talk which raised this particular area of computing, that can machines think? If machines can think, how to make machines think? What kind of a paradigms are required for that? What kind of a systems will be at play to do that? How the future should shape up for that? And then this Newman, V. Newman, professor at mathematics, he said that I would like to be there when this particular match happens between man and machines. And Turing said that, okay, from 100 years from now, maybe we'll be able to go to some part of that. So see, what Turing clearly pointed out to was something called a computational thinking. The way in which our education system has grown. So from the childhood, we are being subject to things like mathematics, logical reasoning, English, comprehension, and students, they keep on asking that why? I mean, if I'm going to be specialized in a particular domain, I don't need this. But believe me, that if people are not prone to think computationally, they are not imbibed with the skills of mathematics, with the skills of logic, sooner or the later, they will probably fall behind in the line of evolution. So yeah, it's a fundamental skill for everyone, not just for computer scientists. It is a skill which each and everyone should be imbibed with, so that probably they can make better decisions. And whenever we are talking of intelligent machines, So intelligent machine is not limited to only computer scientists. An intelligent machine this day can create art, can create music, can create logic also. So for that, this is the basic point, computational thinking. So it builds on the powers and limitation of computing processes, whether they're executed by human or by machine. So when we talk about computational thinking, so the simple processes in which we learn in our school days, the simple doing mathematics by hand, doing tabulation, calculation, to Excel, and all the way up to machine learning, all of it is actually fueled by computational thinking. That how to make logic into computer codes and execute them on systems for taking decisions. And then these methods and models which gives us that courage to solve problems and design systems. So each and every aspect of progression which is happening these days are nothing but solving some problems. If you see back in the days when human beings were just in the verge of getting educated or verge of getting educated and on the verge of inventing new things. At the very beginning, we used our legs to travel. Some point of time then, we saw that legs are probably not that efficient to travel. That's the point when human beings, they developed wheels. So wheels obviously gave us some kind of a fuel by which we can travel faster. Then after a certain point of time, they found that wheel with human, probably that was also not the most efficient way of traveling. That's the time when what they did was, they attached some animals to those wheels and humans used that as carriage for their traveling. So this also went for some time and then they realized that these animals, they are also somewhat like human beings. They need to be nurtured, they need to be fed, they get tired, they get sleep. That's the time when this engines came up, right? So with engines, what happened was, if you can fuel the engine well enough, then these engines can run on their own. And at every point of time, what happened was, we created some rules around the systems. This is how the system should behave. This is the rules which governs the system. And this is how the progression was made. And now see today, what we saw that was, so we in the process, we got also got cars, engines, cars which drive first, automobiles, aeroplanes. And finally, what we realized was that probably that was also not very efficient. So that's why what's happening right now is that we are turning to something called autonomous cars. So cars which can probably follow some of the rules which we only created in the progression of civilization, and they can work by the rules, and that we are saying as artificial intelligence, a great marvel. But if you see, the marvel which we have created is here. The machines, they have just been asked to follow certain commands, certain rules, and that's what they're doing. So the real intelligence is coming from here. So as long as we don't keep inventing ourselves, we don't reinvent ourselves, the chances are that we'll fall behind in the race for superiority. And finally, this computational thinking confronts the riddle of machine intelligence. What can human do better than computers? And what can computers do better than human? Is it that we are competing against the machines? Many a times these days, people are actually dazzled with that question, that these AI systems are coming. Is it that I'm going to be redundant in some years time, around the time? Will these machines make me redundant? I personally think that it's a very uneven comparison. Machines are good at doing some things. Human beings are good at doing some other things. So machines should not be seen as competitors to human intelligence. It should be more seen as a complementers. And as and when older things which are redundant, we are all only through our intelligence creating artificial systems which are making these machines more advanced, more active. We are only making those machines, and as time is progressing, what's happening is some older traits, some older professions, they are only getting redundant and newer professions are coming up. This whole field of data science, it came up in the last two decades, and see the kind of professionals that it has created. 20 years back, it was almost unheard of. So whenever we are talking of these autonomous machines, machines which can think, machines which can reason, obviously some traits, some professions will be made redundant, but in the process, many other newer professions will also come in. So artificial intelligence is less than 100 years. Anyone knows what this is? The first one? WhatsApp created by IBM. So this actually happened, so this is actually a game called Jeopardy. So this particular screenshot is from 2011, where the IBM machine, they actually played against the human experts in a game called Jeopardy, where on a computer screen, there are five different topics, many questions for those topics, and the whenever the question is being asked, the human beings who are quite erudite, educated, they answer those. So the IBM Watson machine was pitted against those real humans. And the prize money, so it happens every year. This year it's even bigger, 2020 Jeopardy game. You can look it up on the net. So the machine was the one which won the prize money of $1 million, pitted against the best humans which were there reigning at that point of time. And that shows some kind of a supremacy in which the machine is going. Again, this will raise the question that, can machines think, are they intelligent enough? I'll come to that, the answer for that. Second, I think most of the people in this room knows Echo from Amazon. This is something which can take certain commands of yours. It is trained to do certain modules or certain pieces of things, and then finally run out that particular command for you, do that particular task. So there's also some artificial intelligence that has happened after Turing had predicted that within 100 years, thinking machines will come up. Siri, people who are using Apple, you're regularly conversing with Siri. DeepMind. So this happened in 2016. There is a computer game called Go, which is considered to be much, much more complicated than chess. And in 2016, Google's DeepMind machine, it was able to compete and beat the reigning champion in the game of Go. And finally, this Tay Microsoft. This also, anyone aware of it? Tay from Microsoft? This was a chatbot which Microsoft launched in 2016. An AI chatbot which was mimicking what people are talking about. And what happened was Microsoft had to shut this project down. Why? Because after this chatbot was being trained for some time, and then people started conversing with it, it actually started making racist comments. That's when Microsoft had shut it down, because the comments which it was making was actually hurting the sentiments of many different kinds of people around. But again, looking at it, so this is the kind of progress that AI has made in the last 20 or 30 years. And still, so Turing made that prediction in 1952. And still we are still about some 30 years away from it. And this is already the progress that we have made. Going next to intelligent machines. So where can we say our machine is intelligent? See, one problem with the machines which we have right now. So we talked about the example of that IBM machine, Siri, Amazon Echo, DeepMind. They are trained to do some particular tasks, unlike us. So here in this audience, I think there are people who can drive, who can play chess as well, who can create music, imbibed with multiple traits, multiple parts of the intelligence taking a place whenever that is required. But these machines, which has been created by so many sophisticated systems, by the supercomputer kind of computing, they can only do one task at a time. Give them some other task, they will completely fail. So when we talk about intelligent machines, the first thing which is required is context aware. What I am doing, the action which this machine will take, is it right for this particular context or not? One. Two is, in this particular context, what kind of action the machine should take? So coming back to the example of that AI bot which Microsoft created, the Tay machine. So though it was intelligent, though it had a lot of learning in it, it was not actually able to sense the context and give out the right kind of a messaging to the market. That is the reason why it had to be shut down. So being context aware and being adaptive to the system, that's also very much important. Third is reasoning and learning. These machines, they have to continuously learn. That is already being done with the current state of the art systems, and also they have to continuously reason what they are learning. Unfortunately, no machine which is there is adept at doing this reasoning part. And finally, the action, which is actually an outcome of all this context awareness, adaptiveness, and this reasoning part. So when we talk of this cognition or cognitive computing, so these are the building blocks of a cognitive computer. First part is perception. How you sense the environment around you, process those information within you, and then attention to some specific details in the environment. So in the particular information, all the kind of information which is flowing around, what is that which is of most important right now? What is that you should pay attention to? Then comes reasoning of all the perception which is happening, of all the attention which you have made to capture some particular information. What kind of a reasoning, what kind of a logic can come out of it? Based on that, you do some decision making. Language use is obviously another part of it. Memory, very much required. Learning, continuously the system is learning, paying attention to what's going around, and taking some decisions, actions based on it. So this is a vicious cycle which continuously happens, and that is what makes these machines intelligent and actionable. So three capabilities that differentiate cognitive systems from the traditional systems. The first one is understanding. A system which has a lot of cognitive power inside it, it must learn continuously. A continuous learning should be there for this kind of a systems. Second is reasoning. Not only learning is sufficient, but reasoning. What kind of a reasoning should be there, which is fit for that, for a particular context which is there right now? That those kind of a reasoning should there. Reasoning, understanding, and then decrypting whatever is the information which is there. And third is learning from all those pieces, and then continuously reinventing itself. So for cognitive computers, these three are the building blocks. So if you are saying that you are creating a cognitive system, if any of these building blocks are weak, chances are that that system will fail altogether. So for AI, so our human beings, they excel at things like common sense, morals, abstraction, dilemma, dreaming, and these cognitive systems, they excel at locating knowledge, pattern, machine learning, eliminate bias, and endless capacity, which comes from all that computing parts. So again, coming back to the question which I raised, that should machines and human compete? Should machines be pitted against the tasks which humans are good at? Should humans be pitted against the tasks which machines are good at? I think not. What the world believes is that slowly, maybe in 2 decades down the line, these machines and human beings, they will work in tandem together, and together they will make some bigger task accomplishment which is not possible in the current state-of-the-art systems. State-of-the-art application which comes from this cognitive applications. Modeling, human-computer interaction, AI, robotics, and engineering. I'll just show you some of these applications. Cognitive robots. This is something which is true as of today. It is not any science fiction. It is true as of today. So there is a RoboCup which is being played every year. Typically, Japan has been leading in the RoboCup missions. But the vision is that sometimes in the 21st century, the winner of the RoboCup will be able to compete with the winner in the FIFA World Cup and probably come out emergent as winner out there. So the agents which plays in this RoboCup are nothing but robots which have been trained to collaborate and compete against each other to win the match of football. Then Roomba. Roomba is nothing but a robotic vacuum cleaner which cleans your home. This is also available in Amazon these days. The current Roomba machines which are there, it's not the state of the art. So if you keep something like a laptop in front of the Roomba, chances are that it will sweep out the laptop also. So they're trying to make better variations of Roomba. But again, soon, maybe in the next 2 to 3 years, we'll find these systems being more efficient compared to what is there currently. And then the Curiosity rover, which is there, which has been devised by NASA to collect information. So can we make these Curiosity rovers more intelligent compared to what they are? Now, one of the common traits which I'll show you from this cognitive robotics. First one, RoboCup. If here machines, the machines which are playing the RoboCup, they are intelligent by their own, but they are not collaborating amongst themselves, then chances are that they will probably play on their own, but they will not end up winning the match and create a complete chaos. So some kind of a cooperation, collaboration is required. Same for this Curiosity rover. If it's not able to assimilate the information which is flowing all around, the kind of temperatures which is there, the kind of soil on which it is rovering, chances are that it will not probably function to the full extent. Come to something called cognitive mediation. So what it says that with the help of machines, how humans can be more productive. So the one on the left is a screenshot taken from the movie called Minority Reports. Tom Cruise was there. So this particular movie was a classic example of how humans and computers, they can work in tandem to see what's happening in the future and also stop some events which are not supposed to happen. So Craig Mundy, chief Microsoft researcher, he said that the time is coming when this computer shifts from a tool, which is from being a tool of using everyday life to being some kind of a human assistant. So that's the kind of computing that we need. So what kind of a paradigms are required for that? I think in the last one day in this MLDS, many of the people, many of the speakers, they have talked a lot about neural networks. There's a lot of investment going on this neural networks. It is basically trying to mimic how human beings work, how the brain works, and trying to put that into machines. But again, another different paradigm of thought is that, is it that we only should look at neural networks? Is it that we only should look at how human beings think? Isn't it our prerogative to look at the environment, to look at the other objects in the environment, and try to figure out how they work? Because we are not working on in isolation. We are working in tandem with many social systems, many objects, many animals. So that's a new paradigm which is going on the market right now. So neurons in the news, human brain project. So back when neural network was not even that much popular, it didn't find mainstream application. 2013 was the time when this big project was announced, where the European government, they had put in $1 billion to the research of this brain, how the brain works, and a lot of papers are coming out of that. But again, as I said, that is it only the neurons or the human mind which we should be looking at. A new trend which is there, which is called escaping biologism. So as I'm saying that, why we should only look at humans? We tend to think that human beings are probably the ones which are most superior. So obviously, as I said, that human intelligence is actually creating this machine intelligence or AI systems. But there's a limitation to our intelligence also. If you look into this classical theories, theories which says that whenever human beings' intelligence, it stop. So there are people who will say that aliens came and they imbibed some new kind of a thought, and that's again when the human beings raised. But again, coming to the argument that it's not only the human brain that we should be looking at. They should also be looking at some kind of things which the animals are doing. So a prominent neuroscientist, he said that he studied this octopus, and he said that the way in which the octopus works, its brain structure, its neurons, that is something which probably the human beings also will not be able to attain. So it's high time that people should look at the nervous system of not only humans, but also the other animals, and try to assimilate all that information, all that knowledge into building these intelligent machines. So there comes the concept of mirror neurons. So if you see monkeys, these monkeys, what they typically try to do is, if you throw something at them, they will also probably throw it back at you. They will try to imitate or mimic what the human beings are doing. They will try to mimic or imitate what the superior kind of being which is there. Right now in this context, it is human they're doing. So then scientists started thinking that, can this kind of paradigm be also brought to computers, where the acts of the superior beings, the being which is supposed to be more intelligent, more adept at doing tasks, that can be brought into the computation paradigm and created systems which are good at solving problems. So that gave rise to some area called cognitive prosthetics, where see the person at the bottom right. So they are seeing sound with their tongue. Their sensory organs are not developed or somehow damaged, but they are sensing the sound with the tongue. The other lady on the left of it, they are sensing the sound from some signals which is coming from on the glasses, right? Using EEG, this gentleman on the top right, what he is doing is, he is immovable. He can't move his limbs, he is paralyzed. He can still communicate with the computers. So those kind of paradigms have been possible as we speak. And all of that has not come from these neural networks or the way in which human brains work. So this Australian art performer, what he does is that he uses a third arm. And the signals in the third arm are typically coming from the muscles in his belly. And what this cognitive augmentation, these prosthetics people, what they have done is, they have actually mimicked how jellyfish transmits information. And that has been used to create a tool like that, which acts as the third arm for the human. So, coming back, so cognitive science, as we are saying, it's a study of the minds, but it's not only human minds. You can think of minds of the computers, minds of even the aliens, animals, machines, as things which creates this cognitive sciences. And coming from that, so today everything is computational. The best tool which we have in our hand at this point of time are computing machines, machines which can process a lot of information. So what has happened is, all this information which has been gathered from cognitive sciences, they have been put in some or the other kind of machines. Machines which can process information, machines which can learn, which can work on algorithms. And the underlying idea is to develop computer representations such that the phenomena that has been studied earlier can be put best use to solve some particular problems or maybe solve a vast array of problems. So it's an offshoot of AI, computational intelligence, the main focus, that deals with things like not only neural networks, but fuzzy logic, then swarm intelligence, evolutionary computing, right? To set up software systems which can develop intelligence through an iterative process. So when we talk about computational intelligence, all these branches comes into play. Branches like your neural network, artificial neural network, the second branch, which I think a lot of work is going on. The third one, which is evolutionary computing. Because as and when we talk about intelligent machines, the path to singularity, it says that machines will become so intelligent that they will evolve on their own. Human beings will not be required. For that, some kind of a evolutionary computing is required. Swarm intelligence, as to how these machines can work in groups or swarms. That's also something which is helping creating these robots, RoboCop, all those pieces. And finally, the artificial immune systems. If this machine is prone to some kind of an attack or threat, how it will protect itself? So a classical example of this artificial immune system is something which is there in this rover machine. They have been created with some kind of a mechanism by which at least small threats, small asteroids or damage, they will be able to repair themselves on their own without the help of human intervention. So swarming is indeed powerful. See the structures which are there, which are nothing but some structure created by ants and termites. It's quite difficult to create the intricacies of those structures by normal human beings. How do they do it? So they attempt to design algorithms by using distributed systems. So these things like this ants, birds, termites, they are not very intelligent. They are no way intelligent compared to us. But what they do is, they follow some simple set of rules, some small rudimentary rules, and they also interact a lot with the environment, take a lot of cognitive feedback from the environment, and then act upon their task. So by the process of collaboration, by the process of learning from the environment, from the systems, they are able to accomplish tasks quite complicated like this, right? So wise form, first is obviously, if we are in a group, we are in a team, we are able to perform, carry out tasks which are possibly not done if we work on their own. If there are some threats, some enemies, we are able to ward them off better. And finally, to migrate also, to go from one system, one paradigm to another, it's always better to work in groups, in teams, that's what we do, so that we are able to accomplish something much bigger. And see, it is not that it is coming by chance. These social insects, they have survived for billions of years. If we take the Darwinian theory, which says the survival of the fittest, so these people, these animals, they have survived for millions of years. So probably they are quite fit or quite adept at doing what they have been created for. So it's high time that we also learn from this kind of a systems. So how swarming happens? First is a collective behavior in decentralized self-organized systems. So though they are working in tandem, in groups, there is no boss kind of people who's sitting on the top and telling them, hey, you need to do this, or you're going wrong, you need to do this. It's ingrained in their DNA as to how they should cooperate and work together, and that's what is making them quite efficient, and they survive millions of years on that. So that is what this swarm intelligence is doing. So some of the examples in nature is the swarm of bees, how they are creating their nest, collecting all the honey, storing it, and they can be extended to similar things like ant colony, flock of birds, traffics, crowds, immune systems. So all these are great applications of how swarming can help do multiple tasks. So why insects for computing? So first is that they don't have the complicated brain structure that we have. They have very fewer number of brain cells, probably in hundreds or in thousands. So whenever you talk to some neuroscientists, they will tell that it is very difficult to mimic what is there in the human brain. Fine, since we have agreed to that, that it's very difficult to mimic the human brain. So rather than trying to only mimic the human brain, we should also look at systems, the other systems, which are probably far more simpler, but still they're adept at doing some particular task. So that's where the insects are coming in. And these organized insects, they have been actually known for the kind of architectural marvel that they have created. If you see a beehive, if you see the kind of nests which these ants created, even the birds, their simple nests. Though it seems simple, if you see the structure, it's quite complicated. It is designed in a way so that it can withstand all the blows from the nature. It's able to withstand the test of time. So not really very easy, right? So it was observed in the 1950s that if you leave a single ant by its own, it will probably start looking out for people in the social circuit. If it's not able to find out people in the vicinity, after some point of time, it dies also. So things, smaller animals like ants are quite social and they can cooperate and do big tasks. Let's see at how they're doing it. And ants are interesting. If you have seen this classic movie from Disney, A Bug's Life, you see the kind of things which these ants have done. They have fought against adversity. They have collected food for themselves. How they do it? So you can do this test right today after you go back to your home. So probably wherever you find a swarm of ants, put some food away from it. What it will do is, it will slowly go towards that particular food. Now create some obstacle. Maybe put in some water, put in some stone, and create some hurdle. Initially what they will do is, they will scatter all around the place. You'll find that they have become confused. But again, if you don't disturb the system, after a certain point of time, you will once again find the shortest path to the food. How does that happen? Let me show that to you. So on the left hand side you have this nest, on the right hand side you have this food, and here are two ants. So both of them, they have equal probability of selecting the paths. So path A or path B can be chosen, and then this food is there. So one typical behavior of ant is then that as and when they're traveling or traversing a path, they deposit some kind of a chemical on their path. That chemical is actually called pheromone. Many of the ant species, they're actually blind. They can't see. But what they can sense is the path on which this pheromone is there. So if this path has pheromone, so probably some of my fellow compatriots, they have traversed this path. So probably it's a safe path. Let me also travel on that particular path. But again, you see that given both this route, one route is shorter than the other. So one of the ants which had started on the shorter route, it will reach the food faster compared to the other ant which had started on the longer route. So what will happen is this particular ant will go from the nest to the food quicker, and then on the way back also this food to the nest, that will also be faster compared to the other ant. So in the process, what is happening is, since it's traversing the same path again, the chemical or the pheromone which we talked about, that gets deposited more on this shorter path. In the longer part, what will happen is the ant will traverse the path from the nest to the food. That chemical or pheromone will get deposited. But it also has this peculiar characteristics of evaporating with time. So because that is the longer path, it takes a longer time to travel, traverse, and go back. So the evaporation of pheromone or the chemical on that particular path will be much faster compared to the shorter path. So then after a certain point of time, you'll find that the path on which the pheromone is on the highest side, that path more and more ants will start traversing. And as more and more ants will traversing the path which is shorter, what will happen is the pheromone deposit on that particular path will also become higher. The amount will increase. And the shorter path, it will slowly, the pheromone or the chemical traits will evaporate from it, and none of the other ants, they will find this path suitable to traverse. So yeah, this is the thing which happens. After many iterations, more of the ants, they will start using the path where more deposits are there. And finally, you'll find that all the ants are only going in the path where more pheromone are there. The other bigger path, longer path, will not be traversed at all. That's how it happens. So what happens is that this particular phenomenon, what this computational scientists have done is they have converted it to some kind of a meta heuristic, some kind of a algorithms or systems by which some large optimization problem can be solved. There are classes of problems called this traveling salesman's problem, which is in computer science theory called NP-hard problem. It requires some kind of a greedy search kind of a thing. And if the number of cities in traveling salesman, it increases, I think, beyond 8, then right now, the computing system which we have right now, it will probably take more than 2 years to solve those problems. But using this simple algorithms from ants, computer scientists have been able to come to near optimal solutions for this traveling salesman problem. So how does this ant colony algorithm works? It's a meta heuristic, as I said. First is, whatever problem which you are having, construct some kind of a solutions for it, a partial solution, where you identify the variable which is required, identify the kind of constraints which is there, identify the goal function which is there. So like here for the food path, the goal of the ant was to find out the shortest path. Here also find out some kind of optimization function which can be minimized. Put that into the paradigm of this ant colony. Second is, apply local search. So there will be multiple feasible solutions for this. So apply the local search, and wherever you're finding a solution which is better than the previous one, apply, deposit more pheromone over it. So what happens in the process is that as and when on the shorter path or on the shorter solution, you apply more and more pheromone. So more and more other agents, other solutions, they also traverse the same system and tries to even reinforce the learning. and for the paths which are longer, which is not conversing into some kind of feasible solutions, they are forgotten. So at the end of the solution, what happens is only the paths which are probably more stronger, more prone towards a good solution, those paths will only remain in the system. All the other paths will actually die down. So various algorithms are there. This one, the first one came out in the early 90s. It's called the simple ANT system, first ANT colony algorithm. So what happens is here in this particular one, the pheromone or the chemical deposits are being updated by all the ants in the system, like which happens in a traditional system. All the ants which traverse a particular path, they update the pheromone or the chemical and reinforcing the path. So that was fine till quite some extent, but then they came up with the second one, which is a max-mean ant system. What they did out here was not only ask all the ants to update the pheromone, because again, computationally, that creates a lot of hassles. A lot of computation goes on for every ant updating the pheromone. So there, what they're doing is only taking the ants which are more fit, the best ants which are right now surviving in the system. So take the clues from the best ant and update the pheromone system. And then a new one, ant colony systems, ACS, fairly new, came out in the early 2000s, where they're doing a local update as well as an offline update. So local update is what's happening within the purview of the system. Offline update is something where after the local system has stopped working, the offline system, it evaluates the best solution and then updates the pheromone on the overall system. So there are many variants of these ant colony systems out there. Unfortunately, what I have seen is that apart from some companies like SAS, no one has invested too much of a resource in developing real industry-grade algorithms for this. So chances are that as we move towards a state where the ANN system is slowly facing some kind of a bottleneck in terms of the technologies which are there, in terms of how much it can do processing, people will probably shift to this other algorithm paradigms. Application, typical application, what has been found is vehicle routing, shortest path. There are some of the algorithms where these ant colony systems have found out to be of huge improvement compared to the other systems. Also in data mining tasks like classification, that's also where ant colony systems are being used, even clustering. So there is a new paper which is there in the market where someone has studied that how ants behave when some fellow ants, they die. We'll find that if some fellow ants die, there will be some congregation of ants in that particular area. They'll try to look at the event, that what exactly happened, why the fellow ant died, and then either we'll leave it there and pick it up back with them. So that metaphor has been used to find out some wonderful clustering techniques, all coming from that ant colony system. The second paradigm which I'll talk about is this particle swarm optimization. So it imitates again human or insect's behavior. So here what happens is individual interacts with itself and also with the nature. And from this, it gathers some kind of a traits or intelligence as to what should the path they should traverse, right? And the implementation is very efficient and quick because it follows very simple rules, very simple rules. I'll show you. So this is an example of a particle swarm optimization where the birds, they are actually trying to hunt that particular bee. In the evening today, when these birds, they're going to the nest, if you see in the sky, what you'll find is that these birds, they go in a flock. They're moving towards a particular direction, all of them. But they are not colliding against each other. They are going at the same velocity, not colliding against each other. But at the end of the day, they are going back to their nest or to the solution for which they were intended to. So this particular paradigm has again been applied in bits and pieces in cognitive systems to develop systems. And how it's being done? First rule, that avoid collision. So when you are working in a cluster, don't collide with the other members in this particular cluster. So taking the example of the RoboCup which was happening, if the robot, it collides with his own team members, obviously that's not a good idea. So there should be a mechanism in which you can stop collision with the neighboring birds, one. Two is match the velocity of the neighboring birds. If you're not up to the speed, please match the velocity of your neighbors. Otherwise, you'll probably fall short. Again, on the other hand, if you're going too fast, which is not matching with your neighboring fellows, probably bring the speed down. Make it to a point where they can match your speed. And finally, stay near the birds. So though you will avoid collision, you'll keep the same velocity, don't get away from the flock. If you're out of the flock, again, try to find out some means in which you can go back to the flock. These three simple systems are being used to form this swarm intelligence or particle swarm optimization. And once again, what emerges out is that it's a simple system, no central control. The simple rules are being put in each of the every agents. And the advantage is that even if some of the agents, some of the birds in the system, they are not behaving properly, they can be thrown out of the systems. New birds can be brought in, which has the same logic, same system, and the system will work fine. So in these ages of this cloud computing, if you can model your algorithms in the way in which it uses this swarm methods to solve your optimization problems, if some of the systems, they are not working fine adequately, just bring in more systems, put them into the same rules, and they'll probably be coupled to create a much bigger system which will solve the particular optimization problems. So this is how the algorithm of the particles swarm optimization, it works. So there is some coordinate called the global best, and then some coordinate for the local best. So each of the particle, each of the birds, they have a local best system, and they also have a global best system. At every iteration, what they try to do is they try to improve upon both their local position as well as the global position. So there is one global benchmark and their local benchmark. At every iteration, they will check that whether they have improved in their performance or not. If they have not improved their performance, they'll probably go back to the previous solution and try to look for a newer path. If they have improved on their previous performance, fine, they will again try to look for newer performance areas. So what happens in the process is that, see, so there is a local aspect, there is a global aspect also. So the local aspect is where some kind of a cognition is happening. So it has seen that how it has performed, what was its previous performance, it has learned from the system, got itself updated, and looking for better paths. For the global one, it's actually interacting with the social, with the nature. It knows that in the nature, probably there is a much better position or much better solution which I'm yet to attain. So with this, both these cognitive components and the social component, they will finally converge to a very good solution. As I said, it's a social process. These algorithms, they're quite simple algorithms. And the best part is that, as I said, that each of these agents, they have some kind of a memory of their own. Even if some of the agents, they are offline, they're not performing adequately, you can just remove the systems, get in new systems, and try to increase the overall efficiency of this entire system. And in terms of the calculation, in terms of the algorithm, it has only one component in which you need to focus on, the velocity. So at every step, the velocity is being modified to look for new velocity, and it is being tested against its own best positions versus the global positions. If it's improving on those, it's a better solution. If it has not improved, they are probably throwing that solution away and taking some older solution only. So this paradigm of particle swarm, it amounts to something called as group learning. So here, whenever we are designing some complex systems, some systems as complicated as those RoboCups, some systems as complicated as those machines which is making this Go players lose to Google's machine. So individual minds are some points in the space, and then there are multiple individuals, right? Multiple individuals are there, and at every point of time, what is happening is this multiple individuals, they collaborate with each other, as well as compete with each other. The collaboration part is so that they can get to the global best solution. The competition part is so that each and every agent can compete and come up with a better solution. So what happens in this process of collaboration and competition is that you get rise to the best solution. So this is typically some kind of optimization problem which you have. So the one dot which is up there in the top, that is the global base that you have. And all the other green ones are where the different agents are lying at this point of time. So what will happen is they will start iterations and they will go to, so every time they will find some position which is better than the previous position, and they will stick or hang on to that particular position. And in the process, what happens is some or the other agent will find the global best, and all the other agents will slowly move to the global best. Simple ways, not complicated mathematics is there, not complicated algorithms or formula is there, but simple paradigms from nature, how that can be used to solve big problems. Okay, so yeah, so if you see that this particular aspect, it also mimics in which we human also work. If you put some people there in this particular room, they'll probably try to find out the place where the group of people are sitting, they'll try to interact with the group, try to learn that what has happened till now, what is there on the cards for the rest of the day. The same kind of thing are being mimicked out here also. So as I said, that the advantages of this swarm intelligence is that they're scalable because the same control architecture is being used across several agents. Several agents, same control architecture is being used. So just by removing one part of the system doesn't stop their system from learning. It will once again retread and learn by its own. And another part is that computationally, it is not that complicated like neural network systems. So as long as you can have sufficient agents and you can bring a control as to controlling this, they will also probably perform to a great extent, not probably as great as the newer breeds of neural network models, but to a fairly good extent, right? And these systems, they are easily able to adapt to newer systems, newer challenges. So yeah, the recent developments, the US military, they have actually used swarm intelligence to develop this unmanned vehicles. How they will work, they have used this swarm intelligence techniques. So NASA, they're also using this swarm intelligence technique to planetary mapping. And this has happened over the last 3 or 4 years. So earlier, as I said, the focus was more on this deep learning, neural networks, everything. But people have realized that this is also a new paradigm which needs to be given attention. Because that, as I said in the very beginning, that the very fact that these smaller animals, they have survived through the nature, they have withstood the Darwin's law, which means obviously there is some kind of a merit to their way of acting. And that is what we are trying to use in our computing systems. So nanobots, they are also being used, they are also being trained in the swarm intelligence method so that they can fight cancer, go to that particular cell where the problem is there, and can probably kill or attack that cell. And the entertainment industry is applying this swarm intelligence to a great extent, particularly the video gaming industry. As and when you see these complicated video games which are coming out, how these agents behave in the video gaming systems, a lot of this these days have also come out from the theories of swarm intelligence. So in coming back, that why you should study swarms. Maybe there's some personal bias, but again, I have used this swarm intelligence algorithms to areas like computational advertising, in which advertisements to show to people when they're on the internet. And in some of the cases, in some particular domains, they have performed much better than the state-of-the-art algorithms which are out there. They're easy to implement, easy to understand, and also computationally effective. And the thing is that, the same question, that where, what should I learn? What are the new algorithms which should come out? This particular paradigm has to stop at some point of time. Every day new algorithms will come, it will only make this ecosystem complicated, complex. But again, if you learn some simple algorithms, and the simpler algorithms which are adaptable to multiple tasks, so chances are that this learning curve will probably come to some kind of a stability, and people will be able to focus more on the applications rather than developing newer and newer algorithms. But there is some problem with this swarming technique also. As I said, that it follows some kind of a optimization process, which is in some part probabilistic, in some parts random also. So it has been proved theoretically that this particle swarms, they will finally go to a convergence. They will find out the optimal solution. But when that optimal solution will be found, there is no answer to that. And in a bad kind of environment, it might so happen that the performance is as bad as a greedy system. Those chances are also there. So though convergence is guaranteed, time to convergence is uncertain and unpredictable. That is where the problem is. That is when our friend Dr. Turing, he comes into the play. He said that this quantum systems, is it possible to build computers that uses laws of quantum mechanics to compute? That is what he postulated. Though he himself was interested in quantum computing, he was not sure of whether quantum computing can exist in practice or not. But what he was pretty sure of was that quantum computing can solve optimization problems in much efficient way compared to the current generation of computers which were there. So these are some of the works which has happened in the domain of quantum algorithms. So particularly in 1994, Peter Shor came up with the Shor's algorithm for finding out prime numbers for integers. And then in 97, Grover, there's another algorithm called Grover's algorithm. What it does is that it finds out the quantum search algorithms which are much faster to our current state-of-the-art algorithms which are there. But again, the implementation of these algorithms, it requires some kind of a quantum systems. And watch this Church-Turing thesis. It says is that until recently, every computing in the planet, be it your iPhone, to be it the mainframes, they follows the same kind of a rules paradigm of computing, bits and pieces, bits and bytes, zeros and ones. But quantum computing is something totally different. So people who have probably read a little bit about quantum computing, they know that quantum computing, at the same point of time, a system can be both in a state of zero as well as in the state of one, unlike the current generation of systems. So what's so special about them? I'll just take a trivial example. So if you see this cat, so in one of the cases, the cat is sleeping, and the other case, the cat is awake. In terms of quantum theory or quantum mechanics, both the state can be possible at the same point of time in quantum mechanics. So finally, even an alert cat can be represented by both a sleeping cat as well as an alert cat, and vice versa. A sleeping cat can also be represented by a sleeping cat as well as an alert cat. So, and Google is saying that they have created a system that can solve problems in this particular domain very easily. And that is when all these doubts are coming in. This is as latest as last October, where Google came up with this this supremacy in quantum computing. And there are a lot of doubts and a lot of papers going on as to what exactly happened. Was it a real phenomenon or not? But coming back to quantum, what I find very interesting is that one quantum kilobyte of data, it encodes 2 to the power 8192 complex numbers. 2 to the power 8192. And if you transfer that to the decimal system, so that is 10 to the power 2466. And the total number of atoms in the universe is 10 to the power 82. So you can understand the amount of information that can be captured in this quantum systems. And if you remember the very first slide where I talked about, so Turing was saying that computers with 100 KBs of memory will be sufficient to create a system which can act as close as human beings. So I think if we are able to solve this computing paradigm of quantum computing, create some algorithms which can take use of it, so probably what Turing said way back in 1952, that is probably going to be a reality. The numbers are staggering. And so all the problems which we are facing with the current generation of system, so much huge data, so much data center to keep, all that will be solved. So let me not come to the quantum algorithms. So finally, with quantum machine learning, the way forward for us is that it has been already observed that they solve optimization problem much efficiently compared to the normal algorithms which are there. But again, also there is a drawback as to the results are unstable. What results you are getting from quantum computing, that is subject, I mean, sometimes it is like the dead cat, that you don't know whether the dead cat will come out or whether the live cat will come out. So what these scientists are postulating is that the current state-of-the-art machine learning algorithms by the traditional systems, they should be used to give some kind of a direction to the quantum computing, but also at the same point of time, the computing power or the algorithm complexity of the quantum computing, which can solve optimization problems much easier, much faster, that should be used. So once again, we are talking of coupling of two kinds of systems, which combined together probably will take us to the next evolution of computing. So when quantum computing comes in mainstream, so all these different areas of work, algorithm design, classical simulation, physical implementation, all that, those places, all those particular streams of work has to be rewritten. That's a problem which I see. But again, slowly, probably, it will get us to something called singularity, where the technical singularity is that the point in time when the computer exceeds the human marvel or the human brain. That is probably something which we are looking at if we are able to solve this quantum computing bit. And as I said, that AI is only as smart as we make it. So as long as we are able to give the intelligence to the system, the machines will be as intelligent as it. So yeah, just to end the discussion. So see, these two events. One is when a big block is falling on someone's head, and the agent which is sitting out there saying that 1500 kgs mass is approaching in your head at 45.3 meter per second. Some kind of a precision information which is there. But is it contextual? I think not. The one on the right is where the agent has sensed that there's a danger. That is probably where. So yeah, finally, to end, so if you see a team of all kryptonites, they have the same problem, identical weakness. But if we are able to get to a paradigm when multiple different kind of systems, they create a team amongst themselves, so probably they'll be able to cover each other's weakness and get to the final solution or the final goal. So I think this is the future of AI. At some point of time, we might be able to make machines which are smarter than us, but how to do, what to do, it's a challenge. A fourth wave is definitely coming, so are you ready for it or not? So yeah, so I see that probably if we try to understand our own self, how humans evolved, how humans came from monkeys, if we strip down our own systems and look at the kind of logics which are ingrained, I feel that the answer is there within us only. We just need to do a deeper introspect. Thank you.